The second construction we're going to talk about is called an internal direct sum. So for the internal direct sum, let's suppose that we've got some big vector space V. Okay, there's V and there's the origin. And let's furthermore suppose that there are some subspaces. Let's suppose we have a subspace I'm going to draw like this. We call it W1. And there's another subspace that we'll call W2. And, you know, I've drawn these as if V is two-dimensional and W1 and W2 are one-dimensional because that's how big the paper is. But in general, you know, this might be 17-dimensional and this is 10-dimensional and this is 7-dimensional. Okay? And let's suppose that we have a very special property. The special property is that for each vector in the big space, there is a unique way to write it as the sum of two vectors with little w1 being in big W1 and little w2 being in big W2. Now this sounds a little bit weird, but in fact, this is what happens all the time. We're used to thinking about R2, for example. In R2, we might call the x-axis W1 and the y-axis W2. So then, every vector in the plane can be written in a unique way as a sum of two pieces. One piece, so this is our vector V, and V can be written as a sum of W1 and W2. Got to get my color straight. Okay, so when that happens, it looks an awful lot like the internal direct sum. We're used to saying that R2 is the direct sum of R and R, except that now it's not just two copies of R that are sitting in Never Never Land, it's the x-axis and the y-axis. We say that R2 is the, you know, has this property that everything in the plane can be written as a sum of something in the x-axis plus something in the y-axis. Okay, when that happens, we say that V is the internal direct sum of W1 and W2. And we use the same notation as for the external direct sum. We write the big space is the first space plus sign with a circle around it, second space. And the reason is that under these circumstances, there's a natural isomorphism between V and the external direct sum. For every point in V, I can give you a particular point in the external direct sum and the other way around. Namely, if you have a vector that can be written as W1 plus W2, we associate that vector to the ordered pair W1, W2. This is sitting in the external direct sum, because the external direct sum is just the set of all ordered pairs. This is sitting inside V. So if V is in one-to-one correspondence, is isomorphic to these, this correspondence respects addition, it respects scalar multiplication. And that's what we mean by the internal direct sum. Last thing is to note the dimensions. We know that the external direct sum is the dimension of W1 plus the dimension of W2. So for the internal direct sum, well, the dimension of V has to also be the same thing. So we need the dimension of V to be the dimension of W1 plus the dimension of W2. And in fact, Here's a theorem about internal direct sums. If W1 and W2 are subspaces of V with two properties, the first is that their dimensions add up to the dimension of V, and the second is that the only place that they intersect is at the origin, then V is the internal direct sum of W1 and W2. Not going to prove the theorem in this video. You can find a proof in the book. But this gives you lots and lots and lots of examples. If you're in R3, just take any plane through the origin and any line through the origin that doesn't lie in the plane, and you get an internal direct sum. In R2, take any two lines that intersect only at the origin. Then the plane is the internal direct sum. Lots and lots of examples.